I'm delighted to have as the guest for the latest episode of the Tennessee Voices videocast, Dr. Adrienne Battle, the now permanent director of Metro Nashville Public Schools. You were given that job from interim to now permanent back in March, shortly after the March 3rd tornado. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great. Thanks so much for asking.
So part of the thing that you've had kind of a double whammy, so to speak. You've had the tornado to deal with, and then you've also had the closures of schools that right now are planned through April 24th. As a leader of the school system, how have you had been able to adjust? What are the kinds of things you've had to do with both staff and students to try to make this work right now?
Well, you know, this has been a very challenging time for us. As you've mentioned, we started out the first week of March with the tornado devastation that hit our city. And what our families and students and staff did was pretty impressive in being able to meet the needs of all the families who were impacted to the best of our ability, as well as consolidate a few of our schools. As you know, and others who may be watching, we did have two schools that we were not able to go back and occupy after the tornadoes due to the amount of damage. And so we had to pull together and had a great lift to make sure that we could accomplish that in just a few days so that school could resume back to a normal state for all of our students and our staff. And just a few days later, just about 3 days after we were able to make that transition, then we did experience the extended closure due to the COVID-19 situation. And so it has been a very different and challenging time for us in Metro Nashville Public Schools, but we've stopped short of nothing to ensure that we can be supportive of our students and families, for our employees who were also impacted, with the primary focus of meeting the basic needs of students and families, but also to keep them engaged in providing as many instructional resources and tools as possible as we face this pandemic. I mean, something that, again, we've not experienced, at least in our lifetime, and don't quite have a handle yet on when we might see the end of it.
Yeah, thank you. We've seen that reporting about bus drivers bringing food to people and all volunteers coming and doing their best to try to keep kids and families fed. Then there's the issue of instructional learning. So one of the things that I'm thinking about right now is, you know, for kids who are graduating, especially be it the eighth grade or high school, you know, how do they rectify this for their own future? That, you know, what does graduation mean for those kids who are affected by COVID-19?
Yeah, for our seniors, this is definitely tough for them. I mean, seniors who have been in school for 12 plus years, many of which have been here in Metro Nashville Public Schools, and here they are at the end of their careers as seniors, last quarter of the school year, and possibly facing not being able to return to say goodbye to their peers, to celebrate, to enjoy events like proms and potentially graduations. And we're still holding on to hope in regards to our commencement ceremonies to really culminate their experiences and to celebrate their next steps into the next phase of their lives. And so they've really been at the heart and core of our planning, understanding the tremendous impact that this has had on them as they prepare for their post-secondary experiences. We've continue to provide as much information at our disposal to our seniors to keep them learning, to give them opportunities to obtain their graduation requirements so that they can still remain on-time graduates from Metro Nashville Public Schools. We want to make sure that any steps we take, any guidance we provide, do not negatively impact our students. Of course, they did not cause any of this, and they definitely couldn't have predicted what we're currently facing. And so we're providing as many supports as possible, as you mentioned, everything from food to them, to electronic devices, to online programming so that they can obtain their graduation requirements, as well as access to any advanced placement courses, dual enrollment dual enrollment or dual credit opportunities to keep them on track. And then also, as I've mentioned, just making sure that we're keeping them up to speed and up to date regarding any events that may have been canceled or postponed, and definitely planning for what their commencement ceremonies may look like. And we're planning for many different scenarios if we're in session. By the time those graduation ceremonies are upon us, we look forward to celebrating with all of our students with any guidance that will be provided to us. But if not, we're also thinking about what it might look like in many different phases, virtually, how we can really celebrate with them and to let them know that we stand side by side with them. We want to encourage them to continue pressing on and definitely to ensure that they can obtain their high school diplomas.
You know, this past year, as you know, the Tennessean has focused on the issue of inequity in public school system, which has been a long running issue. How has this crisis made you rethink those questions of inequities and social and emotional learning, especially as you prepare for the next school year?
Yeah, I think it's really shined a light on those gaps and those inequities. I mean, many of which we knew already existed before these extended closures, but this has definitely accelerated the need for us to continue to fill those gaps. From the very beginning, for me as the interim director and now director, and quite frankly, as an educator in Metro Nashville Public Schools for many, many years, I've always been thinking about ways in which we could personalize the educational experiences for our students. So personalization has always been at the core. And so this really does accelerate the need, the why behind understanding each individual student, what their specific needs are, and us really stepping up to meet those needs, whether it is through electronic devices, additional supports, really thinking about their projections and where they aspire to be once they graduate from high school. And it's our responsibility to really fill their toolbox, their kit, so that once they graduate, they've received all the supports that they needed and they can make informed decisions for themselves. And so this has really just accelerated our focus and our need to fill those gaps, but to be able to do that, not just at a district or systems level, but in a very personalized way.
Well, one of the things that's unique about your background is that you are an MMPS graduate. And so you certainly have the perspective of being on the ground, both as a student, a graduate, an administrator, and now the top leader. I want to shift to one other thing right now, which is how are you doing and how are you coping with this? What are things you're doing to help you get through this pandemic?
Yeah, no, that's a great question because, you know, when we started out on this journey, we were out for the tornadoes. Then we had an extended spring break, and then we extended through April 4th and now through at least through April 24th. And so you begin to realize real quickly that this is really not a sprint. This is a marathon at this point, because these experiences, these challenges will forever impact the way in which we approach public education. And so right off the bat, I found myself really jumping in and trying to, from sun up to sundown, execute upon everything for our students, our families, and our staff. And we've begun to really bucket where we are and how we're going to phase up our approaches across the board for everyone. And so just like I would encourage our employees, I've had to encourage myself and really set some parameters around start and stop times. I've been fortunate enough to be able to get out and exercise, walking, jogging, biking, just to make sure that I, as passionate as I am about the work, that I continue to maintain a quality of life that allows me every day to really plug in. I'm a mom. And so just like everyone else, I'm having to shift and become more calibrated around how to lead the great district I'm able to lead, but also to be a great mother to my young ones as well. Just being able to spend time with them, read a book, engage in some of the academic programming that we've been afforded, and just really balancing life. And so as I encourage others and send out tips around setting boundaries and setting up good routines and structures, that is something I've also tried to model.
You know, that's one thing that you talk about structure. That can be hard for some people who are, for the first time ever, their parents, their workers, they're trying to homeschool, and then they're also trying to do their own work. What are some tips you might have to help them find that discipline?
Yeah, one of the things is just encouraging everyone that you're not going to solve for everything every day, and definitely not in one day. And so giving yourself the okay to really phase things out, taking out bite-sized chunks of tasks and goals that you have, and then being able to think that through, not only on a daily basis, but over weeks at a time. And so that's something that's been helpful for me, is really setting out some goals and then aligning tasks that allow me to progress towards those goals each day and each week.
Sure. One of the challenges too that we see when we talk about these inequities is the access to technology. And right now, you and I are doing this video conferencing technology, which is great for me for this show, and I appreciate you being on. But for kids who don't have this access, what might we learn from this situation to help them gain greater access to the tools that they're going to have to learn in order to be as competitive as possible in the future?
Yeah, that's a great question. So first, I will say one of our goals as a district is to be able to meet some of that need. And so we've started having device distributions at many of our sites across the city so that families and students who are in need do have access to obtaining devices. But that's only part of the challenge here, because they also would need to have internet access to access some of the digital tools and other learning tools that are online. As we're thinking about this, and the needs for our families, the realities have changed. When we surveyed families and students a year ago, the realities are much different. And so if we asked the question a year ago, do you have a device at home that you could utilize for learning and for resources? The answer may have been simply yes. Well, today the reality is that parents are home working remotely. There may be multiple siblings at home. And so while that answer was yes, and probably still is yes, that we have a device at home, when you're thinking about just the equity issue, you still have to make sure that you're reassessing it through a personalized manner. So with mom and dad being home, possibly working virtually, that might be that device might be consumed the majority of the day. And if you have multiple siblings, they also need access. And so we're rethinking the way in which we even ask that question and really survey the individual needs of our students. And I think this current reality will force us to assess things differently and to think more individual student-based. I want us to get to a point where, as we're assessing needs when it comes to equities, when it comes to gaps we're filling, when it comes to the individual needs of our students, that we're talking about individual students and not just kind of addressing them from a holistic or high level vantage point. This is really about digging into the family dynamics, the community resources, and how we're thinking about those structures aligning to what we might call the normal state of education. So as we're planning instructionally in-house, we're thinking about structures, routines, access that all students need to be afforded, regardless if we're in the virtual or the traditional setting. So as we're thinking about blended learning opportunities, the reality is that blended learning opportunities should always exist for our students. It should not be just a pick up and go when you're facing something like the COVID-19 school closures, but should really be embedded in everything that we do with instruction as far as our students are concerned. And I've shared before, there's not a playbook for this type of school closure, but what we want to do here at Metro Nashville Public Schools is to be prepared in the future for anything of this nature ever happening again. We want to make sure that there's not a delay and there's not gaps in getting students what they need, that they already have it and feel comfortable in any blended learning or virtual setting.
And as a longtime administrator, you know how difficult it is sometimes to manage a budget with limited resources. And this COVID-19 pandemic has really walloped local budgets across the country. You face right now the potential of losing some more funding as well. When you think about these decisions, how do you prioritize some needs over others? Because it's a terrible position to be in. I can't even imagine right now.
Yeah. I mean, we started to bucket these. Of course, right out of the back, we thought about the humanitarian needs that are necessary for us to keep growing and thriving as an organization. And then we immediately moved into this space of support. What supports are needed for our students and families? And the one thing that we realized as we're building upon those supporting plans is that we can't do this alone. Our resources are always typically stretched. We're always doing a lot more with a lot less. And so we're going to continue to assess our needs, really plan out and set the vision for our ideal state in partnership with so many of the great local leaders, nonprofit organizations who stand ready and are on this journey hand in hand with us as we meet the needs of our students. But it is on, the onus is on us as leaders to make sure that we keep that compelling vision in front of us that we can articulate and really advocate around to ensure that the resources our students and families need are always at the forefront of the priorities that we're setting as a district. And I will tell you, our school board has had many conversations with me around this and planning for the priorities that we see before us as we move forward. And while we might not be able to solve for everything immediately, we want to be on a journey that is strategic and aligned to the goals that we have set.
You know, when you talked about reading to your child just a few minutes ago, it got me thinking about one of the things that's been hardest about this closure is that I was reading for the first time with a kindergartner at Buena Vista Elementary. And last time I saw him was over a month ago, I think. And so it really brought a lot of joy. And I say that to say thank you for your service and to teachers who really just have a really difficult and hard job. And we're realizing it more than ever. Before we get, we're nearing our conclusion, but I want to ask you, during this time, do you have any book recommendations, either as a mother or as an administrator, a book or show or other recommendations that people might enjoy consuming?
Yeah, so again, this has been uncharted territory for us. So I've been spending a lot of my time just really studying up around our goals of personalization for our students. But right out of the gate, a few partnerships that we jumped into was with MPT and getting some very engaging and relevant academic programming available for our students and families. So I would encourage them to really tune in and to enjoy a lot of the academic programming, which we've been crosswalking with some of our goals and standards here in the district. I also just recently released a statement with Kent Oliver, and I'm encouraging students to read. And we did give a few book recommendations, but I would encourage students and families to check that out and to just read anything you can get your hands on that is interesting to you or aligned to the learning that was already in place. But for me, it's given me an opportunity to really think about what it is I want available for our students. I'm a graduate of Metro Nashville Public Schools, and the thing that keeps coming back to me is the personalization. I know the great teachers and educators I had an opportunity to work with and who really model for me just being a lifelong learner. And when I think about personalization, I'm finding myself really gravitating towards articles and books that will help us move things along, even in a virtual state. Because it's one thing to think about that when you're in a traditional setting. It's a whole other challenge to think about it in a virtual state so that you don't lose momentum and that when you once you do resume school as close to normal as we have in the past, that you can continue on that journey. And so that's where I am around any educational materials, both for students, for families, and myself. And so I would encourage anyone to find things of interest to you. If you had something sitting to the side that you had a passion around and you find yourself with a few extra minutes, pick it up. Pick up a book, pick up a magazine, an article, go online and find things that will keep you dreaming, will keep you innovating and aligned to where you are and where you want your future to be.
Well, it's great you're working with Ken Oliver of the Nashville Public Library. That's and I know that people can get digital public library cards if they don't have one already. In the last couple of minutes of this conversation, Dr. Battle, would you leave us with some words of advice or wisdom or ways that can help us get through this very difficult time right now?
Yeah, so I first would love to just commend our staff, our adults who have stepped up in big ways, understanding both the SEL and the academic needs of our students and families. They have really stepped to up to the challenge, not missing a beat on what we can't do, but thinking about more so what we can do. And we've been fortunate enough to have a community that's really rallied around us to say, what can we do to help and how can we lend a hand? And I think that's what it's going to take as we move forward. I know that this is a new reality for many of our families. And so we're thinking about them and we're planning on their behalf so that we can be as supportive as we can. I understand and recognize the needs on, again, both the SEL and the academics. And so we too stand side by side with our families for the desires of their students to keep them growing, learning, engaged so that they don't have gaps in their learning as we plan to resume. And so we're thinking about that and we're planning around that and we'll keep acting on their behalf. But most importantly, I think through the tornadoes and every other natural disaster we've experience as a city, and now with COVID-19, we've shown how strong we are as a city. We've shown how strong we are as a district, and we will continue to be resilient, and we will continue to do what's best and act on what's best on behalf of our students and families. And so I just encourage everyone to hang in there, set up those routines, those structures, reasonable goals and tasks every day, and to know that we all stand together. And at any point in time, just reach out to anyone and to be an encouragement to them and to offer your support, practicing safe social distancing and all the precautionary measures that will help us flatten the curve.
Dr. Battle, it's been such a pleasure to speak with you. Thank you for appearing on the Tennessee Voices videocast. And to viewers, you can catch this episode and past episodes at Tennessean.com/opinion. Thank you so much again. Stay safe and healthy, and I hope you have a great day.
Thank you. You too.